Hi, YouTube fans. This is Matt of Post April 6th YouTube channel. I'm awfully sorry that I didn't do any YouTube vlogs in the last week or so because I tell you, I have overcame a pretty bad head cold. Excuse me.
Hi, sweetie. What are you doing? Don't you want to hop up on the bed?
Okay, I'm back. I had a little bit of a coughing fit. Yeah. There's a bad head cold going around the Denver area, and it's really a good thing, like I've mentioned this before, that I use a really reliable cold medication called Cold Snap. Yes. And here is my cat, Isabella. She just hopped up on the bed. Hold on, let me grab her.
Hi, sweetie. Yeah, you're on YouTube. Look. Look into the camera if you can. You're on YouTube. A lot of people love you and adore you.
There, I'll put you down. There you go. And within about the last 45 minutes to an hour, I was planning a video as I was vacuuming my carpet because, whew, a lot of cat litter, lint, and little bits of outdoor fibers, I guess is what you'd call it, not mud, but fibers, were all over the floor. And a little bit of breadcrumbs and whatnot. And I spent a considerable amount of time doing some vacuuming, but the carpeting looks a whole lot better. Doesn't look brand new. It doesn't look like it was professionally clean, but it looks noticeably a lot cleaner. Now, what I think I will go ahead and discuss in this vlog is a movie that came out in 2007 called Zodiac, or The Zodiac Killer. This is another alternate name for it. And what it is it's a movie that stars Jake Gyllenhaal. He plays Robert Graysmith. And Mark Ruffalo, who plays Inspector Dave Toski with SFPD. And it also has Robert Downey Jr. I know Robert Downey Jr. was getting a little naughty there for a while, but after he served his time in jail and he really got deeply involved in drug and alcohol recovery, he's been a pretty good guy. And let's see. The director is David Fincher, and I know a lot of people, there's millions and millions of people that like Denver, Colorado, but there's also quite a few that think Denver, Colorado is, because of its 5,280 feet above sea level, which equals 1 mile in distance, that it's on the edge of a mountain and it snows like 9 months out of the year. That's crap. I mean, yes, it will go through periods where it'll snow a lot for like a week or two, but it won't snow 9 months in a row where it'll only stop snowing for like a couple days and it really starts again. No, it don't work like that. In fact, we'll go through periods in the winter where it will go, easily over a couple of weeks where it doesn't snow. Or if it does snow, it snows very little. Like half an inch, if that. And then a few hours later, the snow's gone. Because of the warm weather that happens the following day. And, David Fincher, I've looked this up before. He's either from Aurora, Colorado, or from Denver, Colorado. It's somewhere in the Denver metro area. I know that for sure. Anthony Edwards played Inspector Toski's partner, which would be William Armstrong, Detective, or Detective Bill Armstrong. And Brian Cox played a very highly skilled defense attorney who was called on KGO TV by, not by the Zodiac himself, but by a guy who was mentally ill, and as his way of acting out, and I guess what would be called delusions of grandeur, or a psychotic skit, or a psychotic misbehavior, dysfunctional antics, called claiming he was a Zodiac when he wasn't. And they found that, they figured that out within a few hours. And let's see, who else starred in there? Elias Kotaz, K-O-T-E-A-S. And Dongle Lagu. Donald Lagu, I believe he played one of the detectives. It was somebody that was with the Napa area, one of the detectives, and he played the character Ken Narlo, a detective, a high-ranking detective. And John Carroll Lynch played Arthur Lee Allen. Arthur Lee Allen, according to what Bill Armstrong and what Inspector Dave Toski thought, they had a strong hunch he was the Zodiac. But several years later, I don't think he was anymore. Just maybe in conspiracy he had something to do with it, but he didn't do the murders hands on. He might have been one of the people that did those letters to the newspapers, you know, the one that would do the ciphers, the cryptography. That might have been how he had his hand in it, where he was involved in it, because he was so good at it, because he was so good at faking his handwriting with his right hand or something. But even then, there's a good possibility that's not true. I know this doesn't make any sense, but, you know, even though I don't really think Arthur Lee Allen is the suspect anymore, I after thinking about this for 7 months, well, maybe he had something to do with it, only in the sense that he did the letters. But you know what? Me suspecting that he had something to do with the letters may not be true at all. It may be just instinct, nothing more. And the instincts are off. My instincts are off. And Dermot Mull, I can't read this very well. I'm going to have to get out these. Okay, I cleaned up the magnifier glass, and it's Dermot Mulroney, R-O-N-E-Y, M-U-L-R-O-N-E-Y. I can't remember if he played Mel Nicolai with the California Department of Justice, or if he was one of the staff members that played a character named Templeton Peck or Templeton something, with a staff member of San Francisco Chronicle newspaper. And, okay, I'm still looking here. And the lady who played Robert Graysmith's second wife, a blonde-headed lady, who her character name was Melanie. I believe the lady who played that was a woman named Chloe. And the last name kind of sounds either Danish or Swedish or, you know, Swiss, Switzerland, or Norwegian. It's one of those last names that's very hard to pronounce. And let's see. Let me pause here for a bit. Okay, after carefully think about this for a little bit, forget the rest of the cast. Juan and I go ahead and get to the facts concerning the movie. They tried to portray, and this character was played by Robert Downey Jr., and Robert Downey Jr.'s character name was Paul Avery. They tried to depict Paul Avery as developing as a guy who developed a serious drinking problem, and that he was also using drugs. He snorted coke here and there, and then he went off the deep end, and he angrily walked out of San Francisco Chronicle after he got a serious as he said in the tete-a-tete or tete-a-tete, a serious disciplinary reckoning with Temple, or Templeton, the guy who used to be called Tim or Templeton. I don't think that type of disciplinary action really actually took place. I think he quit because he wanted to get involved in other things. He wanted to work for SF Examiner or who knows, some other type of media company that was popular, that was in Northern California or Southern California. Paul Avery didn't develop a drink problem. I personally think that even though they don't say much about it, there's probably times where he drank pretty heavily, but he wasn't drinking heavily to the point where he could be clinically diagnosed or evaluated by a support addictive recovery group as a full blown alcoholic. And the other thing that I think is possibly inaccurate was it was one of the two, petting my cat, one of the two men that were violently assaulted, but they didn't get murdered because the murder, the girl got murdered, their girlfriend got murdered. Because, you know, it's said in the movie that one of Zodiac's traits as a murderer is he gets so caught up murdering the women, he forgets to finish off the men. Yeah. Yeah, he gets so, or I think the actual way that they phrased it was he gets so involved in killing of the women that he forgets to finish off the men. Yeah. Like that. They pronounced Michael Majot, and I think his last name was actually pronounced Mago, or something different. And I saw a audio commentary when this movie was being shown on DVD after it had been released onto DVD, that they tried to depict Majot as a guy who was a filthy alcoholic and homeless. Maybe that's true. There's a good possibility that's true. But there's also a good possibility he just became reclusive and kept to himself and was living somewhere else other than that part of Northern California. The part of Northern California I'm referring to would be either Santa Rosa or Vallejo, California, not San Francisco. And I did a Google search, and if Michael Majot or Magot is still alive, he would be at least 72 years old. Yeah, he'd be somewhere between the age of 72 and 79, or no, 80, somewhere between 72 and 80 years old. What's his exact age to the month, day, and the year? I don't know. There's only so much you can find out when you do a search, Google search, or through reliable sources like TruePeopleSearch.com. The other thing that I felt was a bit inaccurate. Okay, after pausing and taking a few minutes to think about this, one of the things that was a little bit confusing about the movie was, yes, Inspector, I can't say detective when it comes to detectives in SFPT Police Department. Inspector Dave Toski was married, and I believe he stayed married to the same woman all his life. And in the movie, he referred to her as my bride. And I think the reason why they did that was because the family for his actual wife would really be irritated if the character Dave Inspector Dave Toski used his actual wife's full name. Yeah. Somebody would have been really irritated. Somebody would have been really irritated, and it might have been Toski himself. Who knows? But using the word "my bride" was interesting. Had a nice little uniqueness to the character. Okay, now what I will do is I will go ahead and state some reviews that are on the DVD itself. A quote by David Anson, A-N-S-E-N, of Newsweek. He says, "Fascinating and uncompromising. Zodiac holds you in his grip from start to finish." Yep. And I think what they mean is Zodiac the killer himself, not Arthur Lee Allen per se, if that makes any sense. From Peter Travers of Rolling Stone magazine, it says, "A mind-bending, non-stop mesmerizer of a movie." Nice choices of words. I like that. And the other thing that I think was accurate about the movie was Inspector Toski's eating habits. Like, they were... He went to go meet Inspector Armstrong at a nearby cafe or a restaurant, and Armstrong is, you know, eating away at a BLT with fries. And he only started with the first half of the sandwich that was cut in half. And then he hands the... Armstrong hands the other half to Inspector Toski. And Inspector Toski puts out a napkin, and then he takes off the tomatoes because he really didn't like tomatoes in sandwiches. And the other thing is a little bit later on in that movie, you see Inspector Toski again go like a, you know, the gesture I just made a minute ago. He pops in what was either Pepto-Bismol or some type of antacid because Inspector Toski suffered from an ulcer problem. Yeah. I think what it was just the stress of being a detective had something to do with it. Or maybe it might have been hereditary. It was one or the other or both. The other thing that was fascinating about the movie, and this isn't about Zodiac himself, it's about how the last day Inspector Toski and Armstrong were partners, and then Inspector Armstrong tell him that he's not, you know, I'm not coming anymore. He transferred to the fraud division as a inspector, not a patrolman, an inspector. And then after he gets out of the car and he hands him like a beeper or whatever type of device he was supposed to give to him, he goes into the entrance of, I guess, what was either a condo or a townhome or an apartment building, and the woman who meets him at the door was a woman who was Asian, who was Inspector Armstrong's wife. Asian lady. Beautiful lady. Yeah, the other thing that happened in the movie, this was about at least 45% of the way through the movie, 50% of the way of the movie, something like that. It was when Avery was still with San Francisco Chronicle. He was a crime reporter. Avery drives out near or to Riverside, California. And he meets him at this gas station that was closed down for business and just kind of been abandoned for at least a year or two. And you could hear the airplanes flying over in the sky. And that may have happened in real life, but it may have been something a little different. And the darkness, the way Robert Downey Jr. playing Paul Avery was walking around, is you know, he says, "Hey, I'm supposed to meet you out here. Hey, hey," you know. That was pretty good acting, I think. And I think he drove up in a Saab, you know, an early to mid 1970s Saab or Volvo vehicle. I don't think it was a Porsche. At least to me, it didn't look like it. And why don't I go ahead and talk about the first time I saw this movie, Zodiac. It was way back in about early March or February of 2007. In fact, I'm going to go look something up to double check that just a minute. Okay, I went to go verify something really quick. And it was released March 2nd, 2007, and I went to go see it, I believe, March 4th or March 11th. It was on a Sunday evening, or a Saturday night when I went to go see this. So March 11th, I believe, was Sunday, so March 10th, approximately. And I was quite delighted to go see it. I really was. I was quite delighted. And it was getting to the point, because we just, you know, between 2006 and 2007, we experienced some very heavy snowstorms. I mean, the blizzard of 2006 was really a doozy. It was the fourth worst snowstorm in the Denver city and county of Denver and the Denver area that this city ever experienced. And it was the second, actually it was more like the second. The only time it was worse was way back in 1913. Because what seems to happen in this city is every 10 years there's some bad blizzards. There was probably a bad blizzard in 1972. Blizzard of 82, pretty bad. Blizzard of 92, bad. Not as bad as 82, but almost as bad. Blizzard of 2002, bad, bad. It was more like 2003 than 2002, after I've had a second to think about it. And 2012, that was when I was living here after I'd gotten released from the hospital, and it was a period of 392 days before I moved back to Pueblo to live with my father, because by the end of 2012 things had collapsed so badly for me financially, I had no other choice. Yeah. And in 2022. It didn't have a blizzard, but what happened right after New Year's of 2023 is it got very, 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 very cold outside. We're talking worse than 10 below, because 10 below in Denver is, even if especially if there's like a 2 to 3 mile an hour wind, it's brutal. It's brutal, brutal, brutal. It's very cold. It feels colder than 20 below. Feels more like 30 to 35 below. It's that bad. You know, like we're talking near North Pole, Alaska area, or the higher upstate area of North Dakota and Minnesota type cold. Yeah. And when I went to go see it at Continental 6, this was the year before Continental 6 turned into Regal 10, because they heavily remodeled in there, I went to see it, and I really, really enjoyed it. I had a wonderful time. And what I did, about 2-3 weeks later, I went to go see it at a movie theater that has since been torn down because they rebuilt that area. It was near Alaska and South Colorado Boulevard. Or if it wasn't that, it was the one that's still there. It was Regal Cinemas Colorado Center. Near the Colorado Station, RTD, light rail station, and park and ride, and the shopping center, where you find the theater, a nice office building. It's got a distinct one-of-a-kind look. And you also can go into Dave & Buster's and have a real good time. But if you're going to go into Dave & Buster's, you better be willing to spend more than $5. We're talking, even if you want to do things fairly cheap, you better plan on spending at least $20. Yes. I mean, eating there and playing the games, unless you have some type of a membership, you can blow over $50 probably quite easily out in Dave & Buster's. Yeah. And then I saw it one more time at another theater that would be, you know, first run instead of third run. And then I saw it at the place that's quite unfortunately no longer open because it closed down. It was Tiffany Plaza 6. Here's some interesting facts. Excuse me a minute. Okay, I'm back. I had to blow my nose, and I also had to take one more tablet of cold snap. So, Tiffany Plaza 6, here's an interesting story about the place. It was originally, before it changed three different times, a AMC theater. Yep. And when my mother was on vacation with her close friend Sue, back in August, did the cat just hop up? Nope. That was just the way the mattress was acting. And I'm sitting on it's sort of a couch, because it has a couch-like feeling. Okay, so in August, again, when my mother was on a vacation to Las Vegas with her friends, her close friend Sue, I was staying with Marge and Keith Yates. They had a really nice house in Surrey Ridge, which is where me and my mom and dad used to live between about the spring of 1978 until we had to give the place up in late February of 1985. Yeah, my dad, here's what was going on concerning the house we lived on in Surrey Ridge. The buyer put a down payment on the house, and then the ability to get a mortgage lender to finance it, plus affording the closing costs, the deal fell through. And my dad really looked tirelessly for a few days to get a house to rent set up, and that was that. We let the house go, and my dad just let them fall to where they were going to fall, and as they were. What Marge and Keith decided to do after they looked at the newspaper, They says, "Well, we're gonna go to Tiffany Plaza." Excuse me. And we're gonna go see Deadpool. That was with Clint Eastwood. Milo's family made since 1946 famous sweet tea. Delicious. Okay, so back to that date. We went to go see the movie, and I didn't realize it at the time because I was only about 15 years old. There's a lot of actors I knew about, but there was a lot I didn't know all at the same time. An actor who later was in the skit comedy or satire comedy TV series. Jim Carrey. Jim Carrey. He played a rock star that where he lip-synced Welcome to the Jungle, that was done by Guns N' Roses, and then and he played a rock star named Johnny something, Johnny Squires, I think, or something like that. And Johnny went into his trailer to go shoot up some heroin because he was a heroin addict. And then before he knows it, a guy sinks in and he pops a really heavy duty, super hot dose pillows of very powerful amphetamine down his throat that killed him. It was done by a character named Harlan Rook. Yeah, Harlan Rook got arrested by, and or got taken out by Clint Eastwood playing the ultimately tough Dirty Harry with his 44 Magnum. Okay, and then what happened is. I believe somewhere between 1999 and 2000s, AMC shut it down. But what did happen was Interstate Theaters LLC, which was also... It was owned by Interstate Theaters LLC, but the managing company was Cinemark. And what they did was they put up a cheap seats. Either a dollar before 6 p.m. and $1.50 after that, which was, even back in 2001, that was pretty cheap. About as cheap as I could get. And then the man that ran it was getting pretty old, and he got too sick to be involved in it, and he passed away a year or two later. This was around somewhere between 2004 and 2006. He passed away. Yeah. And then Starplex ran it for a couple of years, and I went in there to see Zodiac movie, or Zodiac 2007, as I like to call it, or the Zodiac Killer movie. And the seats were pretty torn up, and it looked really crappy. I mean, it looked like a flop house, man. Ew. But what did happen, I forget the exact date verbatim, But somewhere between late 2008 and early 2010, Elvis Cinemas bought it. And they did a lot of remodeling inside there, and they did a lot of reupholstering or just blatantly replacing of the seats. And believe me, it was much classier there after that. However, what did happen, I believe it was prior to 2022 or 2021, somewhere near, Elvis Cinemas at Tiffany Plaza shut down. Yeah, they had to shut it down. They weren't making any money. Because the list of movie theaters nationwide isn't bigger than this. It's going like this. And the few that open up, it'll just go from here to here. Not from here to here. Or wider than that. Yep. It's a fact. Because movie theaters, year by year, little by little, step by step, are getting phased out. It's a fact. And drive-in theaters, there's not none, but it's still few and far between left. Yep. I think there might be one near the Denver Merchandise Mart, but that might have closed. And the one in Commerce City called 88 Drive-In, they've had enough. They're going to shut it down. And how many are left in the state of Colorado? I don't know. I'm going to have to really do a thorough research on that. And after it was released on DVD, I went to check it out, either through Netflix or Redbox DVD, or Blockbuster. Come to think of it, I think it probably was Blockbuster. Because see, that was in the tail end of the days when there was still a lot of them left, but you know, one by one they were shutting down. And then in 2013, by the end of it, there was no Blockbusters left. They shut them all down. It's gone. Renting videos is, well, there's still some places, there's still some areas in the United States that do it, but it's pretty much going by the wayside. Yeah. And even Netflix. They don't do the one at a time membership, two at a time, three at a time membership anymore. Because they don't rent videos whatsoever. It's streaming stuff that you want to see. I mean, that's probably still going strong, but you want to run a DVD through them? Ain't gonna happen. Ain't gonna happen. Nope. Redbox? Yeah. I think there's going to be a lot of those. And I think, I personally think there's going to be more of them in the future. But am I right on that? Next couple of years, we'll find out. We'll find out. Well, that's the end of this video, and I hope that all of you found this interesting. And before I go, I better cover that up, sorry. That's what the back of it looks like. And here's a good close-up of the front. do it that way so there's not that glare on there. There we go. Golden Gate Bridge. Without a doubt. In fact, before I go, I just thought of something. Why don't I play a little bit of the soundtrack music that's in there? Okay. I did some searching, and here is some good classical music that was on the film itself. Okay, here is Easy to Be Hard by Three Dog Night. That is in the opening credits of the movie. I got a feeling I shouldn't play it all, but let me play at least half of it or close to half of it or whatever I feel is best. Let's go for it. Well, that's it now. YouTube fans of my channel post April 6th. Thank you, everyone. Good night, good day, and good afternoon, and goodbye. Thank you.